last week I was reading the slave narrative of Ben Ori, who worked on a plantation in Muriel's Inlet on the coast of South Carolina. Not that far from where you're from, right? Not that my family is from originally from Polly's Island, which is only 5 miles, I think, from Muriel's Inlet. George Miller was around the same place as well. Michelle Obama's parents were from the same area too. You know, the one thing to start off with is this sense that this one area has produced a number of people. I was on a thing with Hootie and the Blowfish, who I don't know quite who that is, except that he was a very nice guy. But he was also from the same area as well, and I didn't know that. So, your community, what was the sense, the description, the community that you grew up in?
Mm-hmm. Well, first of all, let me say it's great to be talking to a fellow South Carolinian. Although here, being here in North Carolina, you say maybe we didn't go very far in life, right?
Yeah, that's one state. Yeah. Yes,
at least you moved up. At least you moved up.
Yeah. But I grew up in a small town in South Carolina, about 85 and 90 miles north of Charleston, and about 3 hours, a bit better than 3 hours, due south of Chapel Hill, something as the crow flies, and the proximity between Chapel Hill and the little town that I grew up in was one of the factors that led me to come here to teach. But when I was growing up in Hartsville, South Carolina, I guess the total population is maybe 5,000 plus, a little bit. About half and half, black and white, you know, separated by the proverbial, railroad. a very small middle class, black middle class, mostly working class. My folks were working class people. But I would say a very tight community, a very close-knit community, where people really did look after each other, and segregated. And because the black middle class was pretty small, they were kind of interspersed among the working class. And so there was a lot of kind of day-to-day communication, across class lines, if you will. Middle class blacks, mostly teachers and preachers. We had one doctor, one dentist, and one pharmacist. I wound up working for the pharmacist some years later. But there really wasn't a strong social division. So I think that the black kids growing up felt watched over in a protective way, an encouraging way. My recollection, which may have been distorted by time, but my recollection was, that there wasn't a lot of crime, that there wasn't a lot of people dropping out of high school before finish. People had to work, and sometimes, they had families maybe a little bit earlier than they should have had families, so they went for that purpose. But my recollection is that it was a fairly close-knit community, and that the teachers and the preachers and the small professional class really did encourage people to achieve, to make the most of their talents, whether it was athletic, whether it was academic, whether it was musical. That's my recollection of it. In some I have, pretty fond memories of the community that I grew up in.
Yeah. And so you went to the local elementary school, which was public?
I went to a Catholic school.
Oh, okay. You too? I'm sorry.
Through what would now be called middle school.
Yeah.
And then we didn't have high school.
Right.
The Catholic school didn't have high school. So I went through middle school at the Catholic school, St. Joseph's Catholic school, and then I transferred to the local high school. High school, yeah.
Okay, so that's interesting. I didn't know
you
that.
You didn't know that?
No, I did not know that.
And I would say that was really pivotal in terms of my own educational foundation.
Yeah, right.
It was pivotal.
Yeah.
The nuns were strict.
Oh, yeah.
But I had the great good fortune of, coming under the tutelage of a nun when I was like 3.5 years old, because my mom and dad put me into the Catholic school. When I was 3.5, my mom had to work.
Mm-hmm.
We needed, like most working class black families, you know, we needed two incomes because nobody was making a lot of money in order to make ends meet. Both, you know, husband and wife had to work. So I was enrolled in kindergarten, just right around 3.5 years of age.
Mm-hmm.
And stayed with the kindergarten teacher,
mm-hmm.
Sister Mary Apollonia, I remember, let's say, for 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
And she taught me how to read before I actually entered first grade. So I was probably four or somewhere.
Right.
And I think probably that was where my love for learning began.
Mm-hmm.
Love for reading and for just sort of being intellectually curious.
Mm-hmm.
That may have happened had I gone to the public school at age 5, 6, who knows.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, as luck would have it,
right.
I wound up in kindergarten at a Catholic school at 3.5 years of age.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that really made a big difference for
me. Yeah, right, yeah. Yeah, I can't say I enjoyed my experience there, but, you know, the discipline of studying was definitely imparted vigorously, so
yeah.
I understand that. So, then, when you were in high school, this is the time that we first started thinking about what we might want to do with our life. What were you thinking?
I was thinking either medicine or the ministry.
Mm.
Now we're talking, in my case, the late 50s, being in high school. And so, you know, it's not like I had a lot of very visible options.
Mm-hmm,
right?
Mm-hmm.
So you either be a teacher, you know, you could be a preacher, you could be a physician. And so I think that, because I had worked for the pharmacists, from the time that I was like 12 years of age until I went to college. And so I had the opportunity to listen almost daily to conversations between and among the pharmacists and the one black physician and the one black dentist, almost every day.
Mm-hmm.
I heard those conversations. So that kind of got me interested in, you know, medicine, at least some area of health.
Mm-hmm.
And I was, you know, a pretty good student in terms of science and math, and so that appealed to me. But also the civil rights movement was just beginning to kind of heat up. Montgomery, you know, Montgomery bus boycott had happened in 56. Certainly when I was in high school, my senior in high school, there were the lunch counter sit-ins in Greensboro. So, and then pretty soon the black ministers are beginning to sort of come to the fore, leadership kinds of things. So I went to college kind of torn, you know, at least open, had an open mind about either of those two directions.
Mm-hmm.
And because I went to college, at an all-black college, Talladega College, just 50 miles east of Birmingham,
right.
In the early 1960s.
Right.
So that really moved me more in the direction of going to seminary.
Mm-hmm.
And so for a while I thought that I would go to seminary. And I majored in psychology and philosophy at Talladega. But then I decided, well, maybe seminary is not quite what I want to do. But I don't want to get ahead of the story, so if you want to...
No, this is fine. This is absolutely fine.
Yeah.
This is exactly what we want to do. So, at Talladega, you shifted from considering both sides and moving more towards the ministry?
Yes.
And then, so how did you decide not to become a major pastor in America today?
Because I decided that the calling wasn't as strong as it needed to be. But also, I was really very interested in science. I never lost my, you know, my interest in science. And so I took a lot of science courses, even though I wound up majoring in psychology and philosophy. I still took a lot of biology and physiology because it interested me.
Mm-hmm.
And so I didn't think that it would be, I just thought that it would be premature to take that step. And I wanted to give myself some more time to kind of figure out, okay, what path should I take?
Mm-hmm.
And so when I graduated in 1964, because I didn't know what I wanted to do, really, and the draft was still in force.
Oh, yes.
and I didn't want to be drafted.
Yes.
Into the Army. But this was before the Vietnam War, so it wasn't that I was concerned about being drafted and then being sent to Vietnam. Mm. I just said, well, you know, I'm young. I have some time. I've been on this sort of fast academic track all of my life. Maybe it's time to take some time out and kind of explore life, explore myself. So I then went into the Air Force.
You did?
Yeah, I took the... Oh, you didn't know that.
No!
Yeah, so I took the Air Force Officers Qualifying Examination, passed it, became a candidate for officers' training school in the Air Force, and went through 3 months of training as an officer candidate, emerged as a second lieutenant, commissioned as a second lieutenant in February of 1965, and I spent 4 years, February of 65 to January of 69 as an Air Force officer. Yeah.
I don't know why that one surprises me so much.
Given the trajectory that I was on, yes, it should surprise you, because you know that's really quite a turn in the road. But it was a very interesting time for me, a very important time. I mean, I grew up during that period of time. I mean, I really did grow up. You know, I just had some really very challenging experiences, which I think did foster my intellectual and certainly my social maturity. Coming out of this little small town in South Carolina, a small black college in Alabama, you know, now I found myself on a wider stage. Legal segregation, you know, had come to an end by that time with the passage of 64 Civil Rights Act. So the world was changing in a way that opened up more opportunities for African Americans. And so being in the Air Force at that time, now on the one hand, you know, that was great because I had, you know, some leadership responsibilities. I learned something about leadership, and you know, was tested in a way that that really brought more skills and more self-confidence. But at the same time, you know, to be in the military, late 64 to early 69, I mean, talk about a critical period in the life of the country, right? A lot of things were happening.
Oh, yeah.
Summer of
68.
Most notably 1968.
Yes, absolutely.
You know, Malcolm X's assassination, Martin Luther King's assassination, Robert Kennedy's assassination.
Right.
I mean, the whole country was turned upside down. So I was in the military and couldn't be an active part of that. But when I did complete my military service allocation in January, February of 69, then I had then decided during that period of time that okay, I want to get a Ph.D. in psychology. Didn't want to go to medical school. Didn't want to go to seminary. I sort of resolved it. You know, resolved that question. And so in 1968, I then applied to several graduate schools in psychology and chose to go to Washington University in St. Louis.
So what made you choose WashU as opposed to some of the graduate schools you applied to were?
University of Chicago.
So all the major.
Yeah, but Midwest. Yeah, I didn't want to go back south. Huh. And I didn't want to go, you know, to the Northeast. Sort of. My then wife and I decided that, well, you know, maybe the Midwest of the country would be a good place to land because it was within relatively easy driving distance, you know, to the south and to major cities, and and was also a big St. Louis Cardinals baseball fan. Bob Gibson was, you know, Bob Gibson, Kirk, one of those guys. I mean, I was a huge baseball fan. But more importantly, and perhaps, you know, for the record, I should say that the chairman of psychology department at Washington University called me up and very strongly recruited me, very, very interested in having me come. And that was really important. That was really important. And again, you know, the eras, the time period that we're talking about is also significant to underlie. We're talking 1968-69, you know, when chairmen of departments and at, you know, all white universities, particularly the, you know, the more elite ones, university presidents beginning to say, you know, the black folks are, you know, are acting up.
Yes, right.
You know, and we just lost a major leader. We need to do more. We need to be more proactive about, you know, about bringing in African-Americans, particularly African-Americans at this point in time, you know, into higher education, opening the door more broadly. So I think the fact that, you know, I'd done well and I'd had some real-life experience, you know, that I probably look reasonably attractive to them. So let's give this guy a chance.
So you got married while you were in the Air Force?
I did. Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah.
This is turning out even more interesting than I thought.
Well, I don't want to make it too interesting.
So then you were at WashU. Now, you know WashU had a reputation, perhaps outside of the psychology department, but it had a reputation, at least in the medical school, of not being particularly, let me put it this way. It had the highest attrition rate of black students in medical school than any other medical school in the country.
The highest attrition rate?
That's right.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yes.
But when I had heard that it was known as wash out.
Yes, exactly. That's exactly the reputation it had. But for you, it was a comfortable environment.
Oh, man. It was fabulous. I had never been so happy. Now, some of that was because, hey, I was out of the Air Force, and I didn't have to worry about anybody shooting at me, you know, from that point on. Because the war in Vietnam was still going on.
Oh, yeah, well, I know.
Yeah, and I'd had two separate orders to go to Vietnam during the time that I was in there, 67 and 68. And so I was very fortunate that you know, the powers that be saw fit to have me stay stateside. So I spent really all of my time in the Air Force in the southwest of the United States. So when I went to WashU, it was just wonderful. I was glad to be out of the military. I could let my hair grow as long as I wanted it. You know, at that time, you know, the afros were...
Yeah, oh yeah.
And in the military, you can't have an afro. Right? Can't have a beard, can't have an afro. You can have a mustache as long as it's sort of, you know, very neat and trim. So when I went to graduate school in St. Louis, you know, I could wear dashiki and, you know, bell-bottom pants, high heels, you know, the big heels. You know,
Do you have any photos? Have you provided any photos we can add to this video?
I probably don't have any. I wish I did. I might have some somewhere, yeah. So, I mean, I just let it all hang out, which was the way people talk about it. Let it all hang out, right?
That's right.
But it was liberating. Right. It was liberating personally, socially, and intellectually. So I just had a wonderful time at WashU.
Interesting.
Yeah, and I credit WashU much like I credit, you know, my formative years in Catholic school as just being pivotal for what I was able to do.
So you enjoyed even the Catholic experience more than I did, I think.
Well, apparently I did.
Definitely. Trust me. Yeah. So here you are, your senior year at your end of your doctoral studies at WashU, and did you start thinking about applying your psychological training to health issues?
No.
At all? Oh.
You're kidding. No, I was thinking, oh, well, you know, maybe I'll do clinical, you know, practice, or maybe I'll become an academic psychologist. I wasn't really entirely sure, even though I was, you know, in the midst of my dissertation, my doctoral dissertation, which was an experimental social psychology dissertation, I became very interested in race relations. And my dissertation advisor, a social psychologist, whose specialty was on race relations. So I became very interested in that, and that was a way of connecting my intellectual agenda you know, to what was happening in the larger society. So that appealed to me greatly, but I wasn't sure really what I was going to do with that. And before I became active in any kind of job search, really, I got a call from Ralph Patrick, who was chairing the search committee.
Right.
You know, to find another psychologist to succeed David Jenkins and Steve Zizanski here in the epidemiology department. So I hadn't even gone on the job market when I got this phone call.
I want to ask a question at some point. I remember, you know, years ago, probably at the time I was taking the doctoral qualifying exam or something, I had a conversation with you and you said how important anonymous exams were, that the doctoral qualifying exam you had at WashU was anonymous.
Yes.
And I thought you said that because you ended up being the top scorer,
yes,
and they didn't wouldn't have expected that.
No.
Could
right.
you put that on the video?
Well, you've said it.
Well,
I think that was right. Most of my classmates were, you know, graduates of Ivy League schools, Harvard and Princeton and Yale and so on.
Mm-hmm.
And I just felt like, you know, boy, I really have to work hard to keep up with these guys.
Mm-hmm.
And I was older, I was like 25, most of them were like maybe 20, 21 or so. So that was another reason why I thought I really had to be above the mountain and work very hard. But yes, as Vic has just indicated, the PhD qualified examination was, one took it without indicating one's name, right? So they were graded blindly by the faculty. I was the top scorer on the exam, and so the professors were very surprised.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I did well in my classes,
yeah.
So,
yeah.
But I really worked hard to prepare for that.
Yeah, in graduate school, I found out it's not where you start out; it's where you end up.
That's where you end up.
Right.
That's right. That's exactly right.
Yeah.
Because I'm sure that, you know, many, if not most, of my classmates, you know, probably looked better on paper in terms of their GRE scores.
Right.
I didn't have a strong psychology major background anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd been out of school for a number of years. So in terms of some of these objective criteria, I suspect that they look better.
Mm-hmm.
But that was just, you know, I guess just gave me more fuel. I think that the impression that my professors had of me as a graduate student was being shaped throughout, you know, throughout the years that I was taking courses and so on. And I felt that I was doing well, but I also think that, you know, my performance on the PhD qualifying examination really kind of sealed it in terms of their ideas about my promise. And I'll just add very quickly that in 2008, I received the Distinguished Alumni Awards from Washington University. I know that you are a distinguished alumnus of this university, so, you know, we two South Carolina guys,
yeah, that's
we haven't done too badly.
Yeah, that's true.
but that was a validation. I mean, it sort of validated the university's high regard for me,
mm-hmm,
and it also validated my high regard for it.
Mm-hmm.
It was just a wonderful experience.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm glad to hear that there's a positive side of WashU. You know, from the health point of view, all I've heard over the years were not as positive.
Well, my older son went to WashU.
Mm-hmm.
My older son went to WashU.
And he had a positive
experience. He had a very good experience.
Good. Excellent.
And my grandson was accepted to WashU, but decided to go to another university.
To where?
Another university.
Oh, okay. So, so you got the call from Ralph Patrick,
mm-hmm,
and what was your reaction to, you know, a field that you hadn't thought about, but, you know, they were...
Epidemiology, what? What did you say? What is that? If I had heard of epidemiology, you know, it would have been accidental or something, I knew nothing about it.
Mm.
But he said, well, come on down and let's have a conversation.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought, okay, you know, it's around Christmas time of 72, and I felt I needed a break, and if they wanted to pay for me to come to Chapel Hill, which is only 3 hours from where I grew up, mm-hmm. who am I to say no? Mm-hmm. You know? Mm-hmm. But I really wasn't very interested. And I knew nothing about it. You know? And I said, well, you know, this will be practice, you know, for going on the job market. And so I came really pretty relaxed. I didn't care much whether I impressed anybody mm-hmm. or not. Mm-hmm. And the first interviews weren't really all that inspiring, to put it mildly. Mm. What do I have to say? What do I have to talk about with a parasitologist? Mm. Right? I knew absolutely nothing about that, or virology. Mm. But over the course of the day, the conversations got more and more interesting. Mm. You know, I met David Kleinbaum, vice statistician.
Oh, yeah.
We're both, you know, Brooklyn Dodgers fans.
Yeah,
He's from Brooklyn and so on. So
right.
Interesting guy, you know?
Yeah.
Maybe he might, it'd be fun to kind of, you know, at least I'm glad I met him.
Yeah, right.
We never see him again, but I'm glad I met him. But more to the point, so at the end of the day, I suspect Vic has heard this point, and maybe you two have heard it as well, Bill. At the end of that very first day, I was here for 2 days, the end of the first day, I had an interview with John Castle.
Mm-hmm.
And I walk into his office, maybe it's 4 o'clock, and I'm pretty messed up. Nope, this is not going to be for me. I'm just going to try to get through this mm-hmm. and get through tomorrow, and I'm out of here to go see my folks. Sit down with John Castle. He's sitting behind his desk, fiddling with his pipe.
Yes, yes.
You know, fiddling with his pipe. And he just starts talking.
Yeah, you know, right.
And about epidemiology, more specifically about social epidemiology, mm-hmm. and why someone like me might actually should be interested in mm-hmm. Being a black Southerner and such, talking about black, white. At the time, we weren't saying health disparities, but he was talking about just
minority health.
Yeah, minority health,
right.
Or you know, the challenges.
Yeah,
and obviously. I didn't know this until much later, but drawing on his own experience in South Africa, you know, as a way of underscoring just how important, you know, appreciation for, you know, social and economic and political and cultural factors are, some of which could be, you know, health promoting, and oftentimes they're not. Oftentimes they're health compromising. And so that if I were interested, know, in being involved in a field that really brought together science and a commitment and interest in social justice, this was the field.
Mm-hmm.
Really? Mm-hmm. You know?
Mm-hmm.
And so because I came of age, as you, Bill, during the civil rights era, you're always looking for ways to, you know, make a contribution, mm-hmm. but to do so in a way that fits who we are as people. Right, so
mm-hmm.
so I began to think that, you know, hey, this might be a way to make a contribution
mm-hmm.
to things I care about in terms of social justice issues, in terms of African Americans, you know, circumstances in African in America, through academics, through teaching, through research. Now, this is something that kind of evolved over time. It's not like I made all of these connections at once mm-hmm. in that conversation, but the seed was planted by his exposition about what epidemiology was about.
Yeah.
Right? This was like. So then I began to think, well, gosh, I mean, maybe this is really what I've been looking for all of my life. You know, what medicine, science, social science, you know, it's like, you know, in a sense, the ministry, you know, healing, bringing people together,
mm-hmm.
you know. I said, well, I began to think, well, gosh, you know, this is so much broader and richer in terms mm-hmm. of possibilities than academic psychology
right.
would be, or that the ministry would be, or medicine would be. And so I didn't think that there were, I'm interested, mm-hmm. you know, I want to know more.
Mm-hmm.
So for the remainder of the second day, I'm sitting on the edge of my seat trying to learn as much as I possibly mm-hmm. can about this thing called mm-hmm. epidemiology. I'm no longer, you know, sitting back and being nonchalant. And so by the end of that second day, I mean, my head is in a different place. About, this is really very interesting.
Mm.
But I didn't think that they were going to offer me the job. I said, well, surely they must have somebody else in mind. But 3 weeks later, I got a call from Ralph Patrick saying, would like to offer you a job. I said, wow. You know, so I thought about it, talked about it with my professors, talked about it with my wife. And we realized that there perhaps a lot of reasons for coming to North Carolina, coming to Chapel Hill. Howard Lee was mayor of Chapel Hill at the time. That was interesting and different and new. And so we could be closer to our parents, our respective parents, our kids, our boys. We had two boys at the time, two little boys. They could be closer to their grandparents.
Mm-hmm.
And there was this exciting feel,
mm-hmm.
you know, that I would be challenged by, I could learn and grow, learn new things. Why not give it a shot?
Mm-hmm.
If it doesn't work out, I can beat a hasty retreat back to something I do know about.
Yeah.
Well, I stayed 16 years, so.
Yeah, yeah. Right.
Well, in the field, you've stayed a lot longer than 16.
I stayed 16 years at Chapel Hill.
Right,
yeah.
Right, right.
Yeah, but I thought, well, I'll give it 3 to 5 years, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And then if it turns out that I'm not, you know, doing what I want to do and things aren't going as well as I want them to go, then I'll do something else.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, so it's been more than 16 years indeed.
Mm. So I'm always fascinated by the John Castle thing, mm-hmm. because I had the same interview,
uh-huh.
the same thing with the pipe, you know,
yeah.
except I was in biostat, you know, at mm-hmm. Georgetown,
mm-hmm.
and the whole thing about developing new methodologies and solve problems,
right.
and like, you know, a different bent on the same theme.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I only got one day interview. I guess they were pretty sure of me in the first place.
Yeah, yeah.
My advisor at Georgetown was married to the person who would advise me at Chapel Hill, and so
was that John Canoni?
Yeah, John Canoni.
Okay,
right.
I didn't realize that your connection went that far back.
That's right, absolutely. I didn't realize how the significance of it until later. But yeah. So it's always been very interesting to me. And the idea of applying these social factors and how it impacted health.
Right.
You know, because I loved biostat. I would have stayed in the math lab, you mm-hmm. know, for years and would have been fine with that. You know, be something like what's his name? Davis. I forgot his first name. But he was this biostatistician, very famous. But when they stood to give him his Lifetime Achievement Award at the American Statistical Association, the audience got quiet, and this woman said, "He's black." Yes, sir. Because I didn't know he was black. You know, even though I had read his stuff. You know,
yeah.
So, but that would have been fine with me. But like you said, the summer of 68, you
mm-hmm.
know, trying to balance this, what you like doing and what you, being relevant.
That's right.
That was the word.
That's right.
You know, learning how to be relevant. So, so then, after your commitment to Chapel Hill, you started thinking about how to apply psychology to the ideas of social epidemiology and so on. So what was the thing that, did you develop John Henryism before you went to Princeville, or what was the thing that got you thinking about how to apply this psychological experience to epidemiology?
Bill, before we get to John Henryism though also, could you also explain how you learned epidemiology? Because you came here on the faculty without ever having taken a course or read a book or anything.
Barely being able to spell it.
What was that first couple of years, those first few years?
Well, it's important to, you know, to mention here that, so even though John Castle hired me, and my understanding is that, you know, I was his last faculty hire, he went on sabbatical
right.
the first year that I was here, which
mm-hmm.
was 1973 to 74.
Right.
So, and then when he came back, 74, 75, it was like a year and a half later that he got sick and,
right.
and you know, unfortunately died.
Mm-hmm.
So, the person who really took me under his wing and kind of facilitated my development as an epidemiologist was Al Terroman.
Right.
You know, I can't say enough about Al. He really, you know, he was a tough mentor too.
Mm-hmm.
He had very high standards, but he took an interest in me.
Mm-hmm.
And so I sat in on his class, cardiovascular epidemiology class. And I would have, you know, one-on-one conversations, you know, with some frequency. I think he realized that because Castle was away, that in a sense, he, you know, would have some extra responsibility for helping me become integrated, you know, into the field. So I sat in on his cardiovascular epidemiology seminar, and then the students were reading at the time about the Detroit study, the Detroit hypertension study.
Ernst Harburg,
right. It's 1970, they published a series of papers in 73, 74. Right. So it was a paper that was published in the Journal of Chronic Diseases in 1973. Sort of a socio-ecological stressors and black-white differences in hypertension, Detroit. And I said, oh, that's really kind of interesting. And because Ernie Harburg was a social psychologist, and there was a lot of psychology and, you know, in that paper, stress, you know, and then in later papers, you know, anger, coping styles, I could relate to that. And so, in a sense, he was a role model for me in terms of how you actually do this, do work. And so blood pressure seemed, you know, was a more salient problem for African Americans, you know, than was heart disease,
mm-hmm.
in a way. It's kind mm-hmm. of a false distinction that I'm making here, but in terms of, you know, sort of the discourse in epidemiology, high blood pressure was much more strongly associated with being problematic for blacks, particularly black males, than was, say, heart disease, which was more so closely associated with white males,
mm-hmm.
because of the type A behavior pattern,
mm-hmm.
which was also very, you know, sort of salient at that time. So Al encouraged me to do a study in North Carolina that sort of, that was modeled after the work that Harburg and his colleagues did in Detroit. So my first paper in epidemiology, which was entitled something like Socioecological Stressors and Cardiovascular Disease Mortality, Hypertension-Related Mortality in North Carolina. So that was published in American Journal of Public Health in 1976, and that came out of Tyroler and Ed Davis's cardiovascular epidemiology seminar. And then David Kleinbaum and I were the two authors on that paper, James and Kleinbaum. And so that was my first epidemiological paper, so I just learned a lot about how to think about epidemiology, you know, through writing that paper and working with David, learning a lot about statistical applications. And that got me interested in hypertension, particularly with hypertension among black men. And should I say more about?
I think probably that's something we might want to save for the class.
Okay.
And the class is going to start in about 15 minutes. So maybe we should pause the video and we can take a little break and we'll relocate down to the classroom.
Okay.
Sound good? Okay, I should have mentioned the date actually. That today is the 27th of February, 2014. Just to be